The meditation program has three essential parts. The first is a code of basic moral conduct. For the duration of the 10 days, students vow to abstain from killing, from stealing, from sexual misconduct, from lying, and from using any intoxicants. Next comes the practice of concentration, or mastery over the mind. In Anapana, students observe their own respiration. They work at focusing their attention on the breath as it enters and leaves the nostrils. As students practice the technique, they experience the turbulent and nearly uncontrollable activity of their own mind. Thoughts, memories, emotions, reveries, even songs arise to overwhelm one's attention. Little by little, the student learns to focus their attention and master the wildness of their own mind. Finally, they will use their heightened concentration to develop insight into their own nature. As they sit quietly, students practice objectively observing the changing flow of sensations, whether pleasant or unpleasant, that arise in the body. They begin to understand the origins of their thoughts and behavior at a deeper level, beyond the intellectual realm of ideas and concepts, at the experiential level. Gradually, they develop detachment toward the compulsive cravings and aversions which control them. This is the beginning of self-knowledge, or wisdom.
Vipassana is a science of mind and matter, how the mind is influencing the body, and in return how body is influencing the mind. And it all happens at the depth of the mind. The conscious mind does not know what is happening deep inside. And one keeps on developing a habit pattern of reacting with craving whenever there is a pleasant sensation, reacting with aversion whenever there is unpleasant sensation. And constantly there are sensations throughout the body, pleasant, unpleasant, pleasant, unpleasant. The conscious mind may not react, but the deep unconscious is constantly reacting. It has become the slave of its own habit pattern of craving, aversion. All other impurities of the mind, all other defilements of the mind are just product of these two, craving, aversion. And whenever one generates craving or aversion, one loses the peace of the mind, the harmony of the mind, the balance of the mind. One becomes a miserable person without knowing that I am harming myself. One keeps on harming oneself. There are other techniques. We are not here to condemn them. Those techniques work at the surface level of the mind to calm the mind, perfectly all right, to purify the mind, perfectly all right, but just on the surface level or maybe slightly deeper. But this works, it starts working at the root level. The root level of the mind is constantly in contact with body sensations. Mind and matter are so interconnected. Constantly, and there the habit pattern of craving, aversion is going on. So you have to break that habit pattern for which you have to go to the depth of the mind. You have to make a part of the mind very sharp. So you join a 10-day course, and 3 days continuously you have to work observing the breath as it comes in, as it goes out. Natural breath. No breathing exercise, not try to control the breath. Natural breath as it comes in, as it goes out, keeping your attention on a small area below the nostrils, above the upper lip. And because you are with the truth, there is no imagination, there is no verbalization, there is no visualization, there is no self-suggestion, auto-suggestion. Just the truth that you are experiencing the breath coming in, going out, and a small area. Continuously are working for 3 days, this makes the mind very sharp, very sensitive. And at the end of 3 days, one finds that you start feeling subtler realities. Besides the breath, there are so many other realities. You feel sensations in this area, different kinds of sensations, which normally you don't feel. Your mind, conscious mind, feels only very solidified, intensified, intense, gross, unpleasant sensation like pain, pressure. That is easy, people feel it. But there are so many other sensations throughout the body, all the time. Some of them are so subtle, just oscillation, very subtle oscillation. So mind must be trained to feel all kinds of sensations. And then from the fourth day onwards, you feel those sensations throughout the body. So you are developing your faculty to enable you to feel all types of sensations in the body. And another part of Vipassana is when you are aware of sensations, you change the habit pattern, don't react. Whether pleasant sensation, unpleasant sensation, just observe objectively. Whatever is happening, keep on understanding, this is not eternal. Whatever sensation arises, it does not stay forever. Very unpleasant sensation has arisen. Gross sensation, it arises, seems to stay for some time, but ultimately passes away. Sooner or later passes away. And when it turns into very subtle sensations, then it is mere vibration. Arising, passing, with great rapidity. So the same characteristic, makes no difference. When you understand that whatever is happening within the framework of the body is constantly changing, that means the entire physical structure, the entire mental structure constantly changing, something which is constantly changing, what is the sense to react with craving towards it or react with aversion towards it? You understand? With the wisdom of your experience. This is not just an intellectual understanding. Now you are experiencing it. So the habit pattern starts changing from the root level. To change the habit pattern at the surface level of the mind, very easy. There are many techniques. People work on that. It gives result. But then if the impurity is at the depth of the mind, accumulated, time and again, there is a volcanic eruption. It comes on the surface and you are again agitated. The whole equanimity on the surface of the mind is gone. So that is why Buddha taught us to go to the depth of the mind and work with the depth of the mind. So the habit pattern is changed at the root level. If the root is decayed, then the whole tree will be decayed. If the root is healthy, then the whole tree will be healthy. So work at the root level. And he gave this wonderful technique. At the root level, mind is constantly in contact with body and body sensations. If you are aware of that and you are not reacting, your mind is becoming healthier and healthier, more and more wholesome. You live a better life. When the mind is pure, free from negativities, free from craving, then it generates love, compassion, goodwill. Instead of negative emotion, you start generating positive emotion, which is good for you, good for others. When you generate negative emotion, you are the first victim of your negativity. You become so miserable, and you make others miserable. Instead of that, if you start generating positive emotion, you feel so much of peace and harmony. And you generate peace and harmony for others also. So you make others also happy. You are happy, others are happy. So this is a way of life, a good way of life, healthy way of life. Instead of making oneself miserable and making others miserable, now you start making yourself happy and make others happy. This is acceptable by everyone because it is not connected with any religion. There is no dogma, no blind belief, no cult, science of mind and matter. And you accept only when you experience something. Don't accept because the teacher says so, or because the Buddha said so, nothing doing. You experience, you find it is good for you, then only accept it. And not only accept, then you live that life. Live a happy life. Blind faith is not involved, and it is so non-sectarian. Anybody can practice. You observe your breath. Now what label you give to the breath? It is not Hindu breath, or Buddhist breath, or Christian breath, or anything. And then later on you start observing the sensations along with the contents of the mind. Say anger arises and there is unpleasant sensation. You can't give label to the anger, Hindu anger or Buddhist anger. Anger is anger. And the sensation that you get is so unpleasant. It's the same with everybody. And when that impurity goes away and you feel so much of peace, harmony, again what label? Peace and harmony is the same for everybody. So non-sectarian. And so scientific, no blind faith is involved. It's a pure mental exercise. As you do physical exercise to make the body healthy, to keep the body strong, this is a mental exercise to keep the mind healthy and to keep the mind strong. Good for everyone. That is why people of every religion, every tradition are participating in 10-day Vipassana courses. Today there is no religion in the world whose followers are not coming to 10-day Vipassana courses. When they come, they find it is our religion. Because every religion has the same teaching as the essence. The same teaching is there: live a moral life, have a disciplined mind, have a pure mind full of love, compassion, goodwill, tolerance. This is the teaching of every religion. But how to practice it? There must be some way, some method, some technique. And here comes a technique which helps you. One becomes a good human being. One is a Christian, one remains Christian for the whole life. A Muslim for the whole life. A Hindu for the whole life. A Buddhist. Be a good human being. Unless you are a good human being, how can you be a good Christian or good Muslim or good Buddhist? So the main purpose of this technique is to make people good human being, peace within. When there is peace within, there will be peace outside. Then only there will be real peace in the world. If the individual is all the time agitated, all the time full of negativity, where is peace? After all, the society is made of individuals. And individuals are so very much unhappy and miserable. And we talk of world peace, what world peace? There can't be world peace. Individuals, of course, it may take time, but once it starts, people will start understanding that there is a way by which, practicing which, we can live a better life. And people start coming. This is what is happening. Last 32 years it has come out of Myanmar. It was maintained in Myanmar for thousands of years, originally from India. Buddha discovered it. And then it was lost in India after 500 years. Different countries it went, there also got lost. One country, Myanmar, maintained it. But there are also very few people, only from teacher to pupil. Rest of them, they never knew even what's happening. Now it has come out of Myanmar, and we find how the world is accepting it. Everywhere people like it, because it is result-oriented. Not that you will get something after death also you will get, but what you get now is more important, here and now. And you get the benefit here and now. People start living more peaceful life, their capacity to work increases, they are more responsible towards their duties, and the human values, enhancement of human values, that is required everywhere in the world, with every community. And this technique gives that result. It is always relevant. It was relevant 26 centuries back. There were people who were living very miserable life, harming others. Today, the situation is worse. What terror is going on all around? And in the name of religion, terror is being practiced, these terrorists, ignorant, because they don't know what they are doing. I see every religion, including the religion of the so-called terrorists, and terrorists is not limited to one community. Every religion has some terrorists. Those who are fundamentalist and extremist, and they say that my religion is the best religion, all other religions are useless, so everybody must accept my religion. Get converted to my religion, then only you'll go to heaven, otherwise you'll go to hell. This kind of thought is harmful. Let people be happy with their own religion, with their own rites, rituals, ceremonies, belief. But the inner essence of every religion is the same. Live a moral life, have a disciplined mind, a pure mind, full of love, compassion, goodwill, tolerance. If that is given more and more importance, then the other things at the surface of the mind, surface of the religion, which differs from one religion to another religion. Let people be happy with their own beliefs and dogmas and rites and rituals, but don't forget the inner essence. So this Vipassana helps you to give importance to the inner essence, live a moral life, Have a controlled mind. Have a pure mind, full of love, compassion, goodwill, acceptable by every religion. So now there is a division between one religion and the other. Actually, if the religion divides, it is no religion. When it unites, then only it is a religion. And the inner essence of the religion is always uniting. The outer shell keeps on dividing. So don't give much importance to the outer shell, where we differ. Give importance to the inner essence, where we agree, all agree. And that is why I feel Vipassana is the answer to today's problem. There are so many difficulties, not only in the name of religion, but in the name of, say, in business also. One becomes so much greedy, over-greed, out of over-greed, one starts harming others. One is a millionaire, I must become multi-millionaire, billionaire, multi-billionaire. By hook or crook, money must come to me without understanding how I am harming others, the consumers, the shareholders. With this technique, when purity comes in the mind, one will never do that. One will earn money, honestly, nothing wrong, without harming the consumers, without becoming dishonest to the shareholders. Then it is good, nothing wrong. Nothing wrong in earning money honestly and make use of it for the good of others also. Make use of it for your maintenance, for the maintenance of your family, maintenance of all those who depend on you. And then also for the good of the society, after the money comes from the society. So a part of it should go to the society with all the compassion, all the love. Otherwise you give donation, a rich man, I give donation, a hospital, I make a school, I make a college. It must be known as Goenka school, Goenka hospital, Goenka college. This madness should go. It is not to build your ego, it is compassion, love for others. The volition must be more and more people get benefit from what I earn. My earning is not only for me, it is also for others. Then the whole system gets purified. It is so helpful. And time will come, because there is so much misery in every field of the society. Politicians, they don't care what they are doing. For them, their position, their power, their chair is more important. To get there, they will do anything. And to keep that, they will do anything. But with this, they won't take any wrong action. They will always look that I am here in this position to serve my people, to serve my people. So the attachment to power will become less. Serving people will be more important. So in every field, Vipassana will be so helpful. And it is helpful, getting helpful. From the student age, we give courses to children in schools, courses to the students in the colleges, and wonderful results are coming. There is memory becomes strong, very sharp. Their ability to understand the subject becomes clearer. And character building, of course, from the childhood, they have got good character building. Similarly, courses are given in the prisons. Hard criminals, these terrorists, when they are in the prison, they take courses, one course, two course, three course, a big change. Change starts coming. The officers in the jail, they can't agree what happened, how it happened. There's no magic, no miracle. It is an exercise. By this exercise, they change themselves. So it is relevant everywhere, everywhere. It must spread. There is no complication of this philosophy, that philosophy, believe in this or not believe in this. That creates complication. But simple, you do physical exercise, say you do yoga. It is so simple, but it helps you to keep your body healthy. Similarly, it is so simple, you observe your breath. Then you start observing your sensations. You observe what is happening in your mind and how the mind and body are interrelated. And see how you are reacting. Out of ignorance you are reacting and harming yourself. When you realize that, you stop reacting. You don't harm yourself. Nobody wants to harm oneself. It is simple. Only when people have not taken a course, then they keep on thinking, oh, this is not my religion, this is another religion taught by Buddha, so it must be Buddhism. I also had the same fear in my mind because I was born and brought up in a very staunch, conservative Hindu family. And this is Buddhism. No, not for me, not for me. Ultimately, I decided when I heard all this, I said, all right, let me take a 10-day course. As a trial, let me see. After giving the trial, I found it the same in our religion also. It's the same with every religion, but no practice is there, mere theory. And that theory also gets complicated with this philosophical belief, that philosophical belief. My God will help me. My God will help those who are followers. And this God will help those who are followers of that. And that God, what we have done of the poor God? What we are doing? We have degraded all these things and given so much importance to these things, not necessary. Importance must be given to morality, which is good for everyone. Let people believe in this God or this philosophy or that philosophy. Don't quarrel. Let them. Let people be happy with their own. But don't forget the essence. Essence of every religion is morality, humanity, that is given by this practice. And it is simple, certainly simple. 10 days people have to spare, which looks too much. Oh, 10 days, how can I give 10 days? But once you pass through it, you find these were the best days of my life.
The Buddha and you talk a lot about suffering. Isn't this pessimism? Oh no, it is optimism. Optimism. Someone is sick. A doctor comes, he says, look, this is your sickness. I'll give you medicine, you'll come out of sickness. Is the doctor pessimistic? If the doctor says there is no way out, you have to die, your sickness is bad, then yes, pessimistic. Here is Buddha, he says there is misery. True, there is misery, but there's a way to come out of misery. I give you that medicine, come out of misery. World has not got any optimistic better than Buddha. A very optimistic person. I am already happy. Why should I practice vipassana? I'm glad you're happy. But don't you want to become happier? Become happier. Become happiest. And here is a way. Here is a way. Are you enlightened? If I say yes, will you believe? If I say no, then you run away. This fellow is not enlightened. Whatever I am today, when I compare what I was before coming to Vipassana, such a big change, such a big change. I was such a hot-headed person, such an ego-centered person. What a change has come. I am so happy with that, so satisfied with that, and that is why I am sharing this peace and harmony with others. Why do you bring your wife on stage? Because I am incomplete without her. She is half and better half. In Dhamma, male or female are equal. So one is not complete unless both are together. And she gives lot of service in Dhamma, gives training to Hindi-speaking Indian women. They feel more confident to discuss with her. And while I am talking, she keeps on giving her vibrations of love and compassion, and you all silently. Because of that, you keep on listening very calmly because of her. I am thankful to her. Do you think Islam is basically violent? Oh, no, no. In Vipassana, there is no religion in the world today whose followers are not attending Vipassana courses. Their leaders are attending Vipassana courses. And I keep on discussing with them. I was so elated, so happy to see Islam is full of non-violence. So much metta, love and compassion is there. If the so-called followers have forgotten that, Islam is not to be blamed for that. The word Islam itself means peace. When they say Islam walaikum, that means may peace be with you. And in turn, somebody says walaikum Islam, may you be peaceful. Peace, peace. But if one does not practice Islam properly, Islam is not to be blamed for that. Can you comment on the conflict between India and Pakistan? What to comment? A very sorry picture. If both of them practice Vipassana, they will be out of all this trouble. As an artist, can I really help others? Or am I just offering distractions and sensual entertainments to people? Large number of artists have come to courses, they keep coming. A artist becomes better artist. A poet becomes better poet. A writer becomes better writer. All that they produce now will be for the good of the people. And so good, people start liking them. All their product is very much liked by the people. If you are an artist, spare 10 days of your life. Come. Please explain metta. Metta is love. Pure love. Without a trace of passion, without a trace of lust, pure love is always one-way traffic. You don't expect anything in return. Otherwise, a commercial love, you expect something in return. Not commercial love, just one way. And that naturally happens. If the mind becomes purer and purer, it is full of metta, full of karuna, love, compassion. It's the real habit of a pure mind, and it happens naturally. I have done the 10-day course, and now I am trying to practice Vipassana every day. But I have other obligations. How do I sit for 1 hour every day? Other obligations, very important. You are a householder. You have to take care of all your responsibility. The technique does not want you to run away from that. But again, you have to give 1 hour morning, 1 hour evening. You give food to your body. 2 times or 3 times, you don't say, I'm very busy, I can't take meal today. You have to take meals to keep the body healthy, strong. This is the food for your mind. Don't starve it, don't make it weak, don't make it sick. Keep on giving. You will find time if you have strong determination and you will get the benefit. Simply coming to a course of 10 days, experiencing the reality within yourself and not practicing every day, you won't get the real benefit. I have heard that you disapprove of homosexuality and that gay and lesbian people are not welcome. Totally wrong. I want people to come out of all kind of sexuality. But then one has to work. Simply I say, yes, yes, this is also good, this is also good, doesn't help. One should not be a slave of sexuality, whether you call it homosexuality, you call it lesbian sexuality, any sexuality. And this technique will help people to come out of that. Never become a slave of sexuality. How do you teach this to young children? Is it possible? And at what age? What age? Before birth. Every child must be taught before birth. A pregnant mother, when she comes to the course not for oneself, but also for the child. And when one keeps on purifying the mind generates love, compassion, then the vibration that this child gets before birth is so healthy. The child comes out as a Dhamma baby. So many pregnant mothers come to the course to get Dhamma baby. I want Dhamma baby. And yes, they get Dhamma baby. So before birth. How do I know that I am practicing correctly? Keep on examining yourself. If you are really practicing as you are asked to practice, a change for better is bound to come in your life. If no change is coming, you are same as before, something wrong. Either the technique is not good or you are not good. But technique is good because it's giving result.
So something wrong. You are not practicing properly. Meet your teacher and he will guide you if there is anything wrong. What is the difference between vipassana and anapanasati? Well, vipassana is the next step of anapanasati. As I said, anapanasati is observing the breath as it is. And observing, the mind becomes very sharp and then you start feeling sensations on the body and you switch over to vipassana. Is it better to be vegetarian for a more efficient meditation? Yes, vegetarianism is good, but we don't insist on that. During the course, of course, vegetarian food is given. But as one progresses further, at a deeper level, one starts feeling the non-vegetarian food is not suitable for deeper meditation. So automatically people become vegetarian. We never press them to become vegetarian. But in the course, of course, only vegetarian food is given. Will one 10-day session be enough to be effective in my life? It is beginning, it is kindergarten. You have to become a doctor. Start with that. The longest journey starts with the first step. If you don't take even first step, how will you reach the final goal? Start with it and keep on applying it in life. Keep on daily practice and applying in the life, daily practice, applying in the life. Then you take deeper courses, 20-day course, 30-day course, 45-day course, and now 60-day courses have started. You will go much deeper to take out the impurity at the deepest level. Before taking the 10-day course, should one be able to sit or meditate for a period of time? No, don't do that. Come with a clean slate, better. Otherwise you start practicing something which may go totally against vipassana and then to retreat from that will be difficult for you. So come with a clean slate. Are you saying that normal emotions of crying or happiness are not to be encouraged? We should be calm and not feel anything? Oh no, you are not like a vegetable, let anybody come and cut, I don't feel anything. Oh no. The feeling will be there, but remain equanimous with that. Equanimous with that. Emotion arises, that accept the fact, emotion is a reason. And you're not reacting to it. You're not reacting to it. If it's a positive emotion, you're enjoying it, yes, but without attachment. If it's a negative emotion, you observe it is impermanent, it passes away. So make use of this technique to come out of all the negative emotions. Is this merely brainwashing? Yes, it is mind washing. It is to purify the mind. And yourself you will experience that I washed my mind. How much I have washed, that much I have become happy. That much I am free from misery. What is the role of God and Guru in spirituality? Truth is God. And you are experiencing truth. Love is God. Compassion is God. You are experiencing. Reach that stage where you become personification of love, compassion, and you are God yourself. Guru, oh no, don't allow anybody to exploit you. Gurudom is not allowed in this technique. Never come under the clutches of a guru. Otherwise he will exploit you. Guru just gives the path, that's all, a good guru. And then you have to walk on the path. You have to liberate yourself. Don't expect that guru will do something for you and liberate you. Any guru says, come, I will liberate you, I will take you to Nibbana, understand something wrong somewhere. Don't accept it. How can I become a teacher of vipassana? First become a pupil of vipassana. Then a time will come, you will also become a teacher of vipassana. Without becoming a pupil, how can you become a teacher of vipassana? In our country, we have got a saying, without becoming first a daughter-in-law, how can you become a mother-in-law? So learn first and be a pupil, and then you will become a teacher. Thank you. Is it better for a couple to take the course separately so each can focus on themselves? Don't worry, you can come together.
there is segregation. Females are separate, males are separate. Let both of them enjoy Vipassana and come out as a happier couple. Is fasting a part of the course? Oh, no. Not fasting. But overeating is harmful for meditation. You will feel drowsy, you can't practice properly. And whole day when you are working, observing the truth, metabolism of the body becomes less. You don't need that much of food, but you get your breakfast all right, you get your lunch. But the evening meal, you get just some fruits or tea or coffee, that's all. So that much is enough. Water is enough for the body, that much is given. But no fasting. Why do you and your assistant teachers and students travel to Burma and sponsor meditation courses there when the government is violating human rights? People want peace. So we have to give a country. We are grateful to that country because it preserved the technique in its purity, and now they have lost it. So it becomes our duty to go and teach those people. And now people are learning this. I'm sure a day will come when even the governing people, they will also come to Vipassana, and there will be a big change.
No. Even though there are many more questions, we have run out of time.
Thank you. I'm liberated. Very good. Right. Be happy. Be peaceful. Spare 10 days of your life and learn this technique for your good, for your benefit, and for the good and benefit of so many others. May all of you enjoy real peace, real harmony, real happiness.
The meditation program has three essential parts. The first...
Vipassana is a science of mind and matter, how the mind is influencing the body, and in return how body is influencing the mind. And it all happens at the depth of the mind. The conscious mind does not know what is happening deep inside. And one keeps on developing a habit pattern of reacting with craving whenever there is a pleasant sensation, reacting with aversion whenever there is an unpleasant sensation. And constantly there are sensations throughout the body, pleasant, unpleasant, pleasant, unpleasant. The conscious mind may not react, but the deep unconscious is constantly reacting. It has become the slave of its own habit pattern of craving, aversion. All other impurities of the mind, all other defilements of the mind are just product of these two, craving, aversion. And whenever one generates craving or aversion, one loses the peace of the mind, the harmony of the mind, the balance of the mind. One becomes a miserable person without knowing that I am harming myself. One keeps on harming oneself. There are other techniques. We are not here to condemn them. Those techniques work at the surface level of the mind to calm the mind, perfectly all right, to purify the mind, perfectly all right, but just on the surface level or maybe slightly deeper. But this works. It starts working at the root level. The root level of the mind is constantly in contact with body sensations. Mind and matter are so interconnected, constantly. And there the habit pattern of craving, aversion is going on. So you have to break that habit pattern, for which you have to go to the depth of the mind.
The Buddha and you talk a lot about suffering. Isn't this pessimism? Oh no, it is optimism. Optimism. Someone is sick. A doctor comes, he says, look, this is your sickness. I'll give you medicine, you'll come out of sickness. Is the doctor pessimistic? If the doctor says there is no way out, you have to die, your sickness is bad, then yes, pessimistic. Here is Buddha, he says there is misery. True, there is misery, but there's a way to come out of misery. I give you that medicine, come out of misery. World has not got any optimistic better than Buddha, a very optimistic person.